Hi, NA Physics. It's Mr. Neff. Today, let's talk about banked and unbanked curves. So this is a concept that's specific to automobiles, but at the same time can be used to figure out how anything that's going around a curve, just dependent on friction, what kind of speed it can do, or what coefficient of friction is necessary, and so on and so forth. So it's easier to understand the idea of an unbanked curve first. So let's look at this. So an unbanked curve is a curve where the wheels of the car are going to ride at the same height. So what I mean is that if I looked at the roadway is here. And so the outside of the curve wheel, the inside of the curve wheel, they are at the same height. So now if you looked at this from the overhead view, you'd see that the road was curving this way and the car's velocity is changing. Okay, like so. And now, if the car's velocity is changing, then we know that we have an acceleration. The center of the circle is over this way, so we know that out of the driver's side of the car, there's going to be an acceleration, a centripetal acceleration, that is equal to v squared over r. Now, what force is doing that? Well, it turns out it's going to be static friction. If we looked at the front of the car, so maybe we were doing the free body diagram from this point of view, we'd see the front of the car like this. Of course, there'd be a big force of gravity, an equally big normal force because we have the roadway is level, and then out of the driver's side of the car, we would have a force of friction. Now, sometimes people want to say that that's kinetic friction because the car is moving, but the car is not moving in this direction. So along this line, the car is not getting any closer to the center of the circle, it's not getting any farther from the center of the circle, and that's because the friction is holding it in place. And so all that to say, it is static friction. Now, we can derive an expression for the critical speed, because you can't just go around here at any old speed you want. There's a speed that's too fast. What would make that speed too fast? Well, in that case, you'd be asking more centripetal acceleration than the force can provide. And so, what is that speed? Well, we're going to start with the second law then. We're going to say that the sum of the forces equals ma, and because this is a circular motion application, centripetal force is the net force, and that's the mass times the centripetal acceleration. So now, the centripetal force, we just got done explaining, is the force of friction static, and that's equal to the mass times the velocity squared over the radius. Now, how big is that static friction? Well, we know that you calculate that by doing coefficient of static friction times normal, and that's equal to that stuff. And so now I might say, well, that's coefficient times the normal, which the normal is the same size as the force of gravity, or mg. And that's equal to mv squared over r. Now, the masses cancel out, which isn't just nice. It says that the mass doesn't matter. And so what I'm about to derive here is going to be good for big things, small things. I don't care what size the car is, if it has the same coefficient of friction, what we're going to do here is going to work for it. And so all that to say is we have the velocity is the square root of three things, the coefficient, little g, and the radius. And so this is that critical velocity. This is if you go at this speed that you are safe, but you're just barely safe. This is probably not the speed that your parents would want you driving around this curve at. That if you go any faster, you're going to be asking for more centripetal acceleration. That is, your velocity squared divided by your radius is going to be bigger than the friction can provide. That means you're going to follow your inertia and you're going to tend towards the outside of the circle, like so. As I ask here, you may have noticed that there's no mass in there. And as I explained, that means that this expression is going to be good for big cars, small cars, whatever. This will give you the critical velocity for going around a level curve. Now, a quick example. Here we have a car safely negotiating an unbanked circular turn at a speed of 21 meters per second. The road is dry and the maximum static frictional force acts on the tires. So you're going around safely, but just barely safely. Suddenly, a long wet patch in the road decreases the maximum static frictional force to 1/3 of its dry road value. It says, if the car is to continue safely around the curve, to what speed must the driver slow the car? Okay, so starting off there, I know that the critical velocity, which they told me that was, is equal to square root of mu sub s, g, and r. Now, the mu sub s after the fact is going to go down to a smaller value. So now this new velocity, I'll make it in blue, is equal to the old mu sub s, but divided by 1/3. And g and r like this. Okay. Now, look at this. I'm going to say that this is square root of 1/3 times square root of mu sub s gr. Now, that mu sub s is the same as this one, and we know that this radical right here is the same as the critical velocity was before. So I'm going to say this is square root of 1/3 of 21 meters per second, and of course that is 12 meters per second. So no, it's not 1/3, it's the square root of 1/3. Still, that's quite a bit slower than it was before. Now let's talk about a banked curve. Now, a banked curve is one where the roadway has been built up somewhat so that the outside of the curve wheel actually sits higher than the inside wheel. And so you can see the roadway is slanted like this. And so the outside wheel is noticeably higher off the earth, away from the center of the earth, than the inside wheel. And so what good is that? Well, what good that is now the normal force, which is going to go like so, it's going to be partially towards the center of the circle. So that normal force, you could think of it as having an x component, force normal x, and you could think of it as having a y component, force normal y. Now, force normal y isn't acting centripetally, but force normal x is. And the benefit here is that even if the road was so slippery that there was no friction, you'd still be able to have some centripetal force. That is because that normal is always going to be there regardless of the conditions. And so all that to say, that additional force that provides the centripetal acceleration is a component of the normal force. Okay, so a similar thing to what I had before, can we derive an expression for this critical speed as we go around the curve without counting on friction? Well, sure we can. So now take a look at this. If I would draw the free body diagram over here, just drawing the car as a dot, and I put it on the incline like this, they'll often give you this angle that they call the angle of banking. Okay. Now that normal force that I'm very interested in is going to go like this, and the force of gravity is going to go straight down. In fact, I'm going to make that just a little smaller, and you'll see why that is. I'm going to say that's the force of gravity. Now I have a force normal x, and I have a force normal y. Okay. Now look at something here. So this angle is theta, and so is this angle. That's an alternate interior angle. This angle is not theta, but it is the complement to theta, and this angle is the complement to that. So I'll say this is theta right here. So now I'm going to say that this force normal y could be thought of as force normal times the cosine of theta, and that means that the force normal x is the force normal sine of theta. Okay, so now I'm pretty much ready to go on this. I can say that the sum of the forces equals ma, and that is the centripetal force is the mass times the velocity squared dividing by the radius, and I'll say the centripetal force is that force normal x, and force normal x is force normal sine of theta. Well, force normal, if you see here, is equal to force normal cosine theta is this y component, and that happens to be equal to the force of gravity. So I could say then that force normal is the force of gravity, mg, over cosine of theta. Okay, stop the video there and check that out for a second if necessary. Times the sine of theta, is equal to mv squared over r. Now, a similar thing happens to what I did last time. The masses cancel, which says that the mass doesn't matter here. The sine and the cosine end up dividing each other to give me tangent to theta. And then, and I still have times g, and now I'll also multiply by r, and I have that is equal to v. I'll put the radical around this side. You notice that this is a similar expression to what I had last time. It's a way to get the critical velocity for going around this banked curve without relying on friction. And so the one noticeable difference is instead of having that coefficient of friction there, it has that tangent theta, which to me makes some sense because it's the banking that's getting you to go around here, not the friction. So how about a quick example of that before I let you go here? Here's one from the homework where they have a banked racetrack. And it says the smallest circular path on which the cars can move has a radius of 112 meters, where the largest has a radius of 165 meters. So I can use that shortcut that I just showed you. I can say that the critical velocity is equal to the square root of g tangent theta and r, like that. My issue is I'm gonna need that theta. So that theta is right there, okay? And I actually need tangent of theta, not necessarily theta itself. So I can see that tangent of theta is the opposite side, 18 meters, over the adjacent side. Now you can subtract right there the 165 minus the 112 and get 53 meters. And so really that is just 18 over 53, which I did off to the side there, 0.3396. So now if I want the critical velocity for maybe part A, the smallest radius, that's going to be the 112 meters on the radius. So critical velocity is going to be 9.8 times 0.3396 and multiply by the radius of 112. Go ahead and run that through, and you're going to get 19 meters per second. Now, if you want to do the same thing for part B, it's everything's going to be identical, except instead of the 112, you're going to have the 165, and you're going to have 23 meters per second.